I guess, you know, there's two different kinds of difficult experiences. One is the short, brief, scary one, and the other is the long, marathon-like one. And the hardest, I'm sure the hardest thing I ever did that I did well was raising my kids, because I ended up raising them as a single parent. And that was from when they were about 5 and 6 on through life, and I was a full-on single parent, you know, 24/7 plus making the money. And I was not the most mature young person in the world, and I made many mistakes. And I gradually kind of lived into the role, I think, of being a good parent. Maybe by the time they were teenagers, I was sort of on the job. And I think that I'm very proud of what I did. I think I did not think of it as hard at the time. I was blessed with a community of friends, and we did things together. But looking back on it, when I look now and I watch my daughter with her little children, I think, how in the world did I do this? And it kind of startles me. And I don't think of all the things I've done in my life, I'm sure that there's none that are more important to me than raising my kids and having things turn out okay.
Gave you this strength to overcome, you know, to keep going and to overcome, you know, being a single parent. What did you?
My friends, friendship, community. It's for me, you know, I hate to say it, I never did like romance very well at all. I always messed up my romances so far. But friendship I've always done well. I've had long friendships, and you know, there's that song, like there's some song about I could never stand without my friends. Well, that's it. That's how I raised the kids. That's how I did anything. And still to this day, you know, it's about a community. One of the things, when my son was in high school, we had a lot of problems with drugs, and what we did was get together a group of the families of other young people who were also having troubles, and we called ourselves a family group, and we kind of circled the wagons around those kids, and we'd have a meal together once every month. It went on for 2 years, and we talked about our lives, and what we evolved a way of doing things where we all brought food. We sat in a circle, and we'd go around that circle every month, and each person, parent and children always saying they didn't want to come, but they always came, talking about what had happened in the month past, and what the challenges were, and what we were going to do. And by the time those 5 young people graduated, every one of them was clean and sober. But our conversation had evolved from talking about their troubles and our worries about them to our own lives. So one father talked about a promotion that he didn't get. One dad had a heart attack, and I took his daughter with us when we went out to California on it. We lived in Massachusetts at the time. And so I think that the biggest thing that came from that experience wasn't getting over the alcohol and drugs. It was understanding that in a time of crisis, if you can get together with people who have same concerns and same values, you can make a difference. And we would look around. I was a single parent. Other parents were, you know, there was a second family. There was an original family. There was someone who was a doctor and a high-level academic. You know, people all different in our, and each of us would have, if we had been isolated, we would have felt it was our fault, and we would have felt bad about ourselves and how failure we were. Together, we could look at each other and say, well, I don't know if I'm so great, but that person's okay. And then you could feel stronger. Well, I think it was the family group, really. I mean, I wasn't altogether a good parent. You know, there were times when they were young when I was a terrible parent, as they still frequently remind me. And so I guess I'm proud of how I made progress, you know? And one of the things, when I think about my parents, one of the things I'm impressed with, they lived to be 84 and 90 respectively, is that they were always making progress. They never stopped growing. And I have many faults and many things that I could do better, and I just keep working on them. And that's what I'm proud of. The family group is a very proud moment. I'll tell you one other proud moment. It's a little bit unusual, but I adopted my daughter when she was 4 days old, And when she was in her 20s, she was having a really hard time. And we read, she read and I read a book about, it was called The Primal Wound, about the problems of adopted children who had been separated from their birth mother, even at birth. She was 4 days old. I nursed her. I was nursing my biological son. And so he was only 9 months older. So in a way, I had said, well, what difference does it make? But it made a huge difference. And because of that, we set out to find her birth family. And we did. And her dad that I told you about, who's a member of Baha'i Faith, and who is a jazz musician, we found him first. It was a research project because the records are sealed. I knew that he was a musician. This in the record, they would give you an abstract that would give you just a few things. And I'm really good at talking, so I would talk to the people in the agencies and try to get them to tell me a little bit more. So I knew his name was Philip, and they told me he was a musician, and he was a member of the Baha'i Faith, and he was in Boston in 1970. So I wrote to the Boston Baha'I website, and I said, I thought this is a rather unique description. He's African American, you know. And I said, does anyone remember this person? Well, had he not been a lifelong committed member of the Baha'i Faith, no one would have remembered him by now. But they did. Two messages I got in a day. Here's his email. And of course, this was also 1999, when I think people were more innocent about, you know, the web was more of an adventure and people were more free with information. But I got in touch with him immediately, and it was because of his lifelong ties with Baha'i jazz artists in Boston. And so we found him, and then we, through him, were able to, it took me another year to track down Kayla's birth mother's family. He told us that she had died when she was only 33. So I thought, well, maybe it's good enough. We found Phil. Let's let it go. But Kayla said no. She wanted to know her birth mother's family. And I then came to realize how important it was to her to know where she had come from, who she looked like, what was the story, who wanted her, who didn't. Even though she was loved and, you know, our family is intact. And so when the first person we found her birth mother's mother, her grandma, who we now think of as Grandma Jean. And I thought, well, I better call her first. Now, this is the white side of the family. I don't know what she knows. I don't know how she feels. I don't know if she wants this contact. We knew that her daughter had died. It could be just grief provoking. So I called, and her husband answered the phone. He's this fantastic old Southerner named CB. They live in Florida. And he answered the phone, and I'm like, I had made up this whole script for what I was going to say because I was really nervous. I said, well, I have some memorabilia from Denise, Kayla's birth mother, from Boston in 1970. And I want to give that to her grandmother, you know, to Jean. I knew her name. And he's like, really? Well, that is very exciting. And he immediately, he was so welcoming and warm, and he was like, she can't wait to talk to you, but she's out. I will have her call you right away. So I must have gone out and found her. She called up, and I was real hesitant. I was still not sure what we were doing here, and I was sort of beating around the bush. And finally, Jean said to me, I think you'd better get to the point. And I thought, oh, okay. So I said, well, I'm your daughter's birth child's adoptive mother. And she started to cry. And then she said, she was like right on it. She's such an amazing woman. She said, I don't want you to think these are unhappy tears. This is the happiest day of my life. We couldn't have been more blessed, because these are people, every one of them, father's side and mother's side, we would have liked to meet for any reason, any time. But we all have, you know, met. We had a family reunion. Phil and Jean got together. Phil and Jean, in other words, Kayla is her birth father's only child. He was absolutely devastated when her birth mother passed away, and they had been parted by then, and all his life had worried about her. Likewise, her grandmother, she's her only grandchild. And so everybody was like, Kayla rules, Kayla's the princess, as she had always believed herself to be, Now her dreams came true. They came to her wedding. Her birth father walked her down the aisle with me. And it's just like a miracle. So that's another really happy story. You know, my dad said he was lucky. My son is a rock musician, by the way. And when my dad died, on that very day, Jonah wrote a song in his honor. And it was called, "Oh, I'm So Lucky, There's No One As Lucky As Me." You know, and he sang it. And now, several schools have taken it. Little kids take up this song. And he showed me a project some kids had done where they're singing, "Oh, I'm so lucky." And then they make pictures. The teacher says, "What are you lucky about?" And they draw a picture of something they feel lucky about. So my father was big on luck. You see, I have this ring. And my father, he came from a very poor family. His father had immigrated from Poland. He was a Polish Jew. He came here leaving a wife and several children in Warsaw. They came later. And when they came, my father was the first born in this country. His mother died when he was 3 months old. Older kids went to orphanage, and my father went to an Irish Catholic foster home. That's where we got to be Catholics. But when he was around six, he had to go back into his family. His father took him back. He had a very difficult growing up. But when he was around 18, he went to a pawn shop and saw a ring like this, only it was silver. And he got it, and he thought it brought him luck. And he went to New York. And he did have a very lucky life. When he got married to my mother, he had one made for her in gold. Now everyone has one. And it turns out he didn't know it, but every symbol on this ring is a symbol of long life and good fortune. It's the scarab, it's the eternal rope, it's the dolphins. You know, it's just like a magic ring. So not that all my life has been so easy, but I do feel very lucky.